Hello and welcome to the Living Healthy Podcast with Dr. Henry Domke. And each week he invites us right into his office here to talk about many and varied aspects of how to have a healthy, rich life.
Yeah.
What an awesome responsibility.
Hey, it's fun to be able to help people when you can.
And to know that when you go to so much trouble to make a proper diagnosis and come up with a treatment plan, and then we do everything you say. That must be gratifying to you.
Yeah, in my dreams, I wish that were true.
Which today's topic is?
Compliance. Because you know what? It's a big deal. I mean, probably 40% of people don't fully comply with their recommendations or treatment plan. I mean, that's the issue.
See, if you charged more, we'd be more likely to do what you told us.
Seriously, whoa, this is very important.
That's
you charge
right,
that much.
Your rates are so low. This is a real problem, or you wouldn't have brought it up. Give us some examples of why we're talking about compliance as a health issue.
I think compliance is a major thing. I think that people die because of it. People are hospitalized because of it. And people suffer because of it. I mean, and it's a complex problem. There's many reasons that people don't comply that are both – some of them are
– Any good reasons?
Yes. There are some good reasons why people don't comply. And then part of the problem is patient problems. Part of the problem is physician problems. They're both very important. In other words, physicians don't communicate properly. Physicians don't understand the patient's wishes. It's complex.
You write the instructions right on the little bottle.
Yeah, right. But, you know, the patient maybe doesn't really want to treat that problem, or they don't understand why. I mean, let's pick an example of a problem that's commonly messed up.
Yeah.
High blood pressure. People frequently – I mean, if you have a sore throat, you'll take your antibiotics.
Because your throat hurts.
Because your throat
Every
hurts.
Every swallow reminds you.
That's right.
To
and
take,
so it's easy to take the medication. Now, the trouble is – many people, though, as they get down to their 9th or 10th day of treatment, forget to take the medication. That's pretty typical with antibiotics. Well, it's worse. So that's an acute problem, just a short-term problem. But say you have a long-term problem, elevated blood pressure, hypertension.
You've got to take a pill every day for the rest of your life.
That's it. And so – and you don't feel sick, okay? With high blood pressure, you do not feel it. So it's like, well, my prescription ran out. I've got to get that refilled in the next – you know, week or month, or, oh, I forgot about it. Or you're traveling and, oh, I forgot to take my pills. Or, I mean, you're just busy and you run out the door and you forget to take your pills. And so your blood pressure is fluctuating tremendously, which can lead to heart attack or stroke. I mean, you know, these blood pressure medications often lose effectiveness very rapidly if you don't take them. So that's a big deal.
See, I mean, that would be enough, that specter would be enough to keep me focused.
Well,
but I mean, I realize that not everybody.
Some people are super compliant, as I think you may be. But
thank you for not saying hyper compliant.
But many people just, you know, taking.
Well, I forget sometimes on the statin, the
cholesterol pill.
I mean,
it's the same thing as high blood pressure pills.
You look in the little bot and you realize you're down to one or two, and you go, oh my gosh, I got to get some more of this stuff.
Well, that's right, and so. I mean, for chronic treatments, it's particularly a problem. You know, you forget to take it. So what can you do? Well, in a case like that, the thing I recommend is get pill boxes so that you can be warned. You know, if you get I've handed these, I think one to you, and I've handed it to many of my patients, a 7-day pill box where there's one little slot for each day. And so like, okay, today's Tuesday, as it is. You open that up. Oh, I didn't take my medication today. And then you take it, you know, later in the day because you forgot to take it earlier. And it's a warning you're about to run out.
When we talk about compliance challenges, for lack of a better term, are we typically talking about medication, either you know choosing not to take it or forgetting to take it? Is it mostly about pills?
A lot of what I'm thinking of would pertain directly to medication, but it gets even worse when you talk about other kinds of recommendations. You know, like say I recommend that you follow the DASH diet. If you could imagine me saying such a thing, or say that you were a smoker and I recommended that you stop smoking. Well, their compliance just, you know, goes way down. And I understand that. And part of that
is
because
it almost doesn't qualify as compliance.
No, I mean, it's a recommended treatment.
The smoker is going to it wasn't like they ever complied, was it? I mean,
well, they never agreed to the plan, perhaps. Okay. Or, but sometimes they do agree to the plan and just can't follow through. So, yeah.
Well, that's true. I should be a little more forgiving here. I mean, somebody says, "Okay, I've quit smoking. Boy, I've made it 3 days. I'm really proud of myself." I mean, in that case, compliance is tough.
It is tough.
I mean, it's
very tough. Behavioral things are.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard enough taking pills, but it's much harder changing lifestyles, and I understand that. And so there, you know. Often it's an issue for the physician. Can they make a sales pitch to motivate the patient? Can they give them information to help them accomplish their task?
Do you feel the need to make a sales pitch, or do you ever
Yes.
find yourself going, hey, you know, I lay it out there. I tell them what they ought to
No,
do.
No.
If they don't do it, it's their deal.
Not at all. I mean, I think if a patient of mine does not comply, that often I'd be more likely to blame myself. You know, patients will come into me and they'll say, you're going to yell at me because I forgot to take the medication the last month. And, well, I never yell at my patients and I wouldn't yell at them. And to me, it makes me feel bad that somehow maybe I could have done something to make it easier for them to take their medication.
Do you ever want to give them a little sort of scared straight talk?
Sometimes I do. Usually scared.
Here's what could happen, Steve, if you don't do this.
I try not to, you know, in general, research has shown that
that didn't work.
It doesn't work very well. I think, I mean, you can just kind of state the facts that, you know, hey, if you don't properly treat your high blood pressure, you're going to have a stroke. But let's talk about what we can, I wouldn't focus on that, though. I would focus on what can be done to take the medication more reliably. For example, one is a pill box we started to talk about. Another is, and I encourage patients to present to their physicians this idea, try to get your medications down to a simpler routine, say once a day.
Oh,
as opposed
I just
to
had
two
a
or
brainstorm.
Three. Yeah?
You can patent this. This could be yours. For your patients who have, you know, mobile phones, which is most of them now, if they're on some kind of medication that's serious, have them set up an instant messaging account. And
I like it.
And you could automate this somehow so that I just get a little, my phone vibrates and go, oh, I need to take my my blood pressure medicine.
I think if you have a complex routine, that's a very good idea. Or I know they make watches that ring multiple times a day.
There you go.
It's the same thing. And that exists now and is a good thing. But what I'm saying is in many cases you want to try to – what as a physician, what I want to do is try to – don't give the medicine two or three times a day. Try to give it once a day if you can. If you're taking multiple medications, try to take them all together, you know.
And I think you told me too, somewhere when we talked about this, that with the statins for the cholesterol medicine, that it may be a little more effective at night. But you have found, as I do, that it's easier for me to remember to take it in the morning.
Absolutely.
And so I take it in the morning.
And that's usually what I tell people, and I warn them ahead of time. I'll say, look, the pharmacy's going to give you a printout that's going to say, you know, take in the evening. But the truth is, you know, if you take it in the morning, so you lose 10% of its effectiveness. But if you don't take it at all, you lose 100% of its effectiveness. So what I usually tell people is, look, if you think it's going to be easier to remember in the morning, because most pills are easier to take first thing in the morning, then take it then, and we'll monitor your blood levels of the cholesterol and see how it's doing. So that's one trick. Try to take it in the morning. Take everything in the morning if possible. Simplify, simplify, simplify.
Sort of implicit in all of this about compliance is that if you give your patients enough of the right kind of information, that they will do the right thing, that they will act responsibly if you can make it easy for them.
Well, it increases the odds.
That seems so naive, Henry.
It increases the odds. You know, Steve, I'm a realist, you know, and I understand. Hey, look, you know, taking medications is not the first priority of most people, and thinking about their medical problems is not their first priority. You know, they may have job issues, they may have family issues, they may be busy, they may be distracted, and so I understand why people are not compliant. I just want to figure out what can I do to help them be more compliant, because it increases the odds of their success. I mean, that's part of it. One of the things that can hurt compliance is sticker shock on the medication. Some of these, you know, I try – one thing you may have learned knowing me over the years is virtually always I prescribe generic medication. Virtually all – you know, I sign my prescriptions on the left-hand side, which authorizes the pharmacist to give you generics. Now, that virtually always cuts the cost, sometimes by half. And so if the medication is very – I mean, many people choose not to take medication because it's just too expensive.
If it comes down to eating or paying your rent.
Yeah.
Or
taking your blood pressure pill.
Some pills. Now, that's a dilemma that I can imagine.
It is a dilemma. So one thing you'll see is I virtually always – now, sometimes, you know, the medication I want to use for a particular problem is not available generically. And so then, you know, are there other ways to help with price? Can you be given samples of the drug? Or some drug companies have plans.
Yeah, I've even heard in some of their marketing efforts, if you're unable to afford this, contact us.
Yeah. If you meet their, you know, criteria, they may give you medication. I mean – it's not used as much as you'd think, but it's a nice idea.
Well, I'm sympathetic. I mean, empathetic. If somebody is on a fixed income and they've got huge, it's amazing sometimes when you hear about people talking $300 and $400 a month.
Especially when you get elderly.
Yeah, medical bills.
You know, typically the elderly are the ones that, you know, and they're retired and they may have less ability to pay, but they're the ones that have more medical problems. Therefore, they're typically taking more medications. So another thing that I recommend is make sure you need all those medicines. If you're elderly, I mean, at every doctor's visit, you should bring your medications with you to make sure that the doctor has the right information. And then you should say, do I really need all these pills? Are there any that I could stop?
Now, that raises a question that's perhaps a little off topic with compliance. But if I bring in this bag of medicine and maybe three or four doctors have prescribed these,
yeah.
I mean, I would think that's
yeah.
– And they ask you, and you said, well, gee, I really don't think you ought to be doing it. How do you doctors handle that between yourselves, or does that even – I mean,
not very well.
I mean, do you call up the other doctor and say, look, I've told her she doesn't need this?
You know, in a perfect world, I would, but I don't.
Okay.
You know, it's just I don't.
You don't have time?
Yeah, that's the way I would explain it. I don't have time, and, you know, I'm just – what I can do is I'll tell the patient, look, I question this, and sometimes I'll write down, please ask Dr. Smith, you know – what if we stop this medication because you're already taking this? I mean, so that's usually – I'll put it on the patient to contact the other doctor.
What happens when it comes the other way and you said, so, Steve, are you still taking your whatchamacallit? And you go, well, you know, I talked to Dr. Jones. And he said I need that. What do you do?
I'll reassess the need. I think it's always – I think, you know, with laws, they have sunset laws, you know, where after a certain period of time, the law ceases to exist. Isn't that the way it works?
Yeah.
But I think that should be true for drugs as well, that you should be required to reassess all drugs after.
Not just forget about it and stay on it forever.
Well, yeah. I mean, usually it's like, well, you're going to, especially again in the elderly, you know, you're going to take this forever. Well,
isn't that how your prescriptions work? I mean, sometimes you'll say, okay, this is good for a certain period of time, and then you have to go back to your doctor.
Well, legally, you can't, a physician in Missouri can't prescribe for longer than a year.
Okay.
That's the limit. So they have to get a new prescription. But it's kind of gets to be on autopilot, and you just refill the prescription. So that's one thing. You know, always, I think it's right as a patient to be skeptical. Say, do I really need this medicine? Could it be taken fewer times a day? Is there anything like this that's available generically? You know, and say, it's important to understand why is it important. Ask your doctor, do I really need this? What would happen if I didn't take this?
What about family members helping other family members with compliance?
Wow, big deal. It's a big issue. You know, my mother's getting increasingly forgetful. And one of the ways that we have decided to help her, because she has to take medicines twice a day, is we'll have one of the kids call her in the morning and say, Mom, did you take your medications? And another kid will call her later in the day and say, Mom, did you take your medications? And we'll actually have her go and pick up the pill box when she's on the phone to verify that she's taken that pill. Those pills at that, so
because otherwise she might not remember or might misremember.
Well, yeah, I mean, as you know, we've had a podcast before on dementia, and as our population is aging, people are getting more forgetful. It's a serious issue with the elderly. I mean, even young people like us tend to forget, and that's where pill boxes are useful for us too. But for the elderly, or those who just don't have the responsibility, I think you want to involve other family members. And sometimes I've heard that you can even have pharmacies make up like blister packs of medications for different times of the day, different days of the week. For a charge, they'll kind of pre-pack them that way.
Well, you've changed my sort of knee-jerk understanding of compliance. I went in sort of thinking, why would some dummy refuse to do what their doctor told them? But now I see that there are a number of, logical reasons, if not good reasons, why people don't always comply, whether it's financial or they forget. They forget or whatever. So
yeah, or they're too – I mean there's just so many things that interfere with compliance. And so, I mean, first of all, make sure you really need the drug, you know. And I mean, don't take it if you don't need it. But if you really need it, if it's a worthwhile goal, then figure out a way to stay with it, you know.
You need to look into my idea with the cell phone.
And
Hi, Steve. This is Dr. Domke. Have you taken your statin today? Have a nice day.
That would be good. So I mean, key issues are 40% of patients don't comply with their doctor's advice on treatment.
That is an amazingly high percentage. I would have never guessed that high.
There are simple things that you can do at home, like we've talked about, and they're going to be listed on the website. I'm going to put a list of some suggestions. So there's things that you can do at home that can help. There's things that you can do during your doctor's visit that can make your treatments more effective. So that's very important. I mean, this is a serious problem. It's estimated that there's 125,000 deaths annually due to noncompliance, and that perhaps 10 to 25% of hospital and nursing home admissions are due to noncompliance.
Boy, what a – I almost said what an easy way to make things better.
To make things healthier. Do it right.
Just do it right. Talk about sort of inherent waste in the system because of compliance.
Well, that's it. I think this is an area of potential high yield. In other words, just a little bit of attention focused here I think could really give us better
health. Doesn't cost
health.
Anything.
That's right.
I mean, this is all straight to the bottom line, as we say.
It is. I think that compliance is – It's kind of a boring thing to talk about. I mean, I think most – you don't see many magazine articles on, hey, let's improve your compliance because, you know, I think it would make most people yawn.
Well, they were like me. They go in thinking,
it's pretty obvious.
You do what your doctor tells you.
But, right.
All right.
More to it than that.
About out of time. You want to wrap it up here?
Good? I think that's about it. Please go to the website. There's some suggestions there. One thing you may notice is that I don't have any links this week. I couldn't find any links. So if anybody out there knows...
You're writing the book on compliance, Dr. Domke.
If anybody knows of any links to websites that have other tips on compliance, I appreciate it if you'd send it to me.
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, we haven't said that maybe ever, but if you have suggested links that ought to be on our website, feel free to send them along, and Dr. Domke will evaluate them. He makes the call on those kinds of things, but... That's going to do it for this edition of the Living Healthy Podcast. I feel healthier. I'm going to go comply.
Thanks, Steve.
All right, until next time, for Dr. Domke, thanks for joining us.